preservation purposes, I would like to make clear Mr. Aguilar is pursuing all the issues raised in his briefing, including whether the board erred.
Right, but you're not, by focusing our argument, we are not saying that anybody waived anything, so you don't need to convince us of that.
Thank you, Your Honor. In terms of Mr. Aguilar's motion to remand, I'd like to focus this court's attention to two errors the board made. First, the board erred in failing to provide a reasoned explanation for its decision. And second, if we get past that initial obstacle, the board did not follow this court's precedent in two material ways. Regarding the first aspect of providing a reasoned explanation, if this court looks to the record, page 5, the board supports its decision with two paragraphs. But if you read those two paragraphs, the board cites one decision from this court. It's an asylum case from 1992 that's been expressly overruled by this court. It gives no discussion of any of the presumed possibly dispositive evidence in this court's decision. Aguilar-Ramos country reports are possibly
let me just point you to exactly what's bothering me in the case, because you don't have a lot of time. I have looked at the entire packet of material that's involved. It's about 250 pages of stuff, and I didn't see much in there that was supportive of your client's position. There was an article from a magazine in 2002 that described five former gang members who were murdered upon return to El Salvador. But by the time this motion to reopen occurred, much more than a decade had passed. And the remaining evidence shows things like a 2012 truce and many other changes that don't support necessarily a reasonable inference that what happened in 1999 to 2002 was still true in 2015. So I guess I had some difficulty seeing why it would be an abuse of discretion to say that there wasn't enough evidence to demonstrate that he would be subject to something different than other people in his home country. That is, conditions generally are turbulent, I think is the word they used. But he hadn't demonstrated an individual change. So what's wrong with the reasoning given the evidence that you submitted?
Yes, sir, I'd like to answer that in two parts. The first part, if we look to the evidence submitted, the 2015 State Department report says, and I'm quoting, kidnapping, torture, and murder of rival gang members is extremely common.
Right, of rival gang members, but there's also something that's not the government doing it, I think there was something that affirmatively said there were no government killings in a recent period of time. And so the fact that there are rival gangs going on, I'm not sure where that gets you.
Well, Your Honor, again, I would like to highlight the fact that the board didn't mention any of this. We're sort of supposing what the board might have done. But
no, the board said they've read all the material and they've made a conclusion about it. And I guess I'm not sure they have to go through an explanation about every page of it. But
I completely agree with you, Judge Harper. We don't want an exegesis for each one of these pieces of evidence. But
what's your strongest evidence that's dated later than 2002 that there's either government activity or government acquiescence in things that would be targeting this individual were he to return?
Yes, Your Honor. I'd point you to record pages 89, 105, and 106, and 121. And just briefly, 89 is a State Department report that talks about the kidnapping, torture, and murder of rival gang members. The reason that is important, Mr. Aguilar will be perceived to be a gang member because of his tattoo. No one's going to stop and ask him, or much less believe him if he says he's no longer there. Second, in record pages 105 and 106, it's a Congressional Research Service report, and I'm quoting, the State Department has reported that Salvadoran military and police have been accused of involvement in unlawful killings and torture. It proceeds, it will be a challenge for SARIN, which is the new regime that came in November of 2014, to ensure that security officials, both police and military, do not engage in human rights abuses when carrying out law enforcement functions, now that they've been given the legal authority to shoot back in cases of gang attack.
And that's, again, generic to
the state reports to talk about Mr. Aguilar.
Well, no, I don't mean to him specifically, but to say people returning from the United States who are perceived to be whatever is suggested. I mean, that's how I read it. And what's at page 121?
121 is a newspaper about Operation Safe House. President Sarin has given these, they're called death squads, these sort of paramilitary groups that are operating, at least in our opinion, under the acquiescence, if not the approval of the government, to go through various sections of towns and raid houses at night looking for gang tattoos. That newspaper sets forth what these paramilitary groups are doing. They're lifting men's shirts looking for tattoos. As soon as the person is tattooed, they're at best unlawfully detained, at worst killed. So,
this is a new government policy, as I understood it, to target gangs much more severely than had been previously the case.
Yes, as the federal government has said, it's a green light to go after gang members. The previous regime from 2009 to 2014, they did engage in the truce that you mentioned. And what it was basically looked at as a way for the gangs and the government to work together, because some people describe the gangs as sort of a shadow government. 2014 comes along with President Sarin. He takes the opposite approach, and he asks now and doesn't, or he shoots now and doesn't ask at all. And that is the stated policy. The vice president is on record saying that they will shoot and not give any of the police any issues whatsoever if they use deadly force. So Mr. Aguilar will, when he gets removed, if he's removed, he will still have that tattoo. He will be perceived as a gang member. There's nothing. No one's going to stop and ask him whether he's active. And if they did, I'm sure Judge Marcy, you see it all the time in the district court, lots of people will say that they're no longer affiliated when it becomes convenient for them. So Mr. Aguilar will be the same as almost every other person walking the street with a gang tattoo. And no one's going to stop and find out whether he is or is not former, whether he has or has not done anything wrong.
There's not sufficient time for him to have the tattoo removed.
He's been sitting in detention for 6 years now. If you read his affidavit, which was submitted with the motion to remit, he talks about him not being aware of any way that ICE would give him the possibility for tattoo removal. He doesn't have the resources for tattoo removal. And if you look to this case, this court's decision in Cole 659 F3rd 762, there's actually a footnote from this court saying that even if tattoo removal was possible, it's an open question as to whether that would have any bearing on cat relief. I see that I've only got 2 minutes left. I'd like to reserve.
Well, it might have factual bearing on whether he would in fact face problems upon return.
Yes. And that's Judge Noonan's concurrence in Cole, is exactly that. It's if there is a way for the federal government to facilitate a tattoo removal, Judge Noonan said he would have voted for the removal. However, because there's no current scheme in the federal government system, especially for a pro se detained individual, which is true for Mr. Aguilar, most of his detention, Judge Noonan voted to actually remand the proceedings to the agency. I'd like to reserve the rest of my time.
You may do that.
Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court, Brendan Hogan for the government. In the instant case, the petition review should be denied because the board properly exercised its discretion to deny the motion to remand. First and foremost, although their analysis is brief under Cole, they're allowed to do so when there is no probative evidence for this for the board to consider. Here, the most relevant evidence, I guess you'd say, would be the UN High Commissioner's report, in which they do talk about former gang members being harmed by the police, and that's at pages 250 to 254. But it's important to note that in saying that former gang members are harmed, it points out that they're harmed because they have the same age and appearance as current gang members. And throughout petitioner's evidence, it stresses that gang membership seems to be a youth phenomenon. Pages 253, 264, and 217, the average age is between 12 to 24. So it's not clear why a petitioner who is approximately 40 would be perceived as his former gang membership, he would be perceived as a threat or somebody that the police would want to target. And with regards to the tattoos, the record is replete with men describing being harassed by the police because of their having tattoos and other markings. And while that's unfortunate, none of those men were harmed. At pages 46, 70, 273, 274, the men are upset, understandably, but no one was harmed. Otherwise, the record in general just shows, unfortunately, that people in El Salvador are subject to violence from the gangs.
There is a new government policy of targeting gang members on site and shooting, isn't there? There's evidence in the record of that that the board did not discuss.
But in that case, Your Honor, I believe it's at pages 105 to 106 of the record. They're talking about shooting back at active gang members, people who are involved in criminal activity. The petitioner does not anticipate being involved in criminal activity or associating with gang members, active gang members. He's at no risk of harm.
Except that there's also evidence in the record of people going around looking for gang tattoos to go after people. So now you're saying that he's too old for that, but it seems like he does have the tattoo, and it seems like that makes him different than all of his countrymen. And the agency said there's no difference between him and any of his other countrymen, which just seems plainly false.
But again, Your Honor, the men in the evidence who were stopped on account of having a tattoo, the police specifically stopped them because they had a tattoo. None of them spoke about being harmed, physically harmed.
And what years were those? Were those after the policy where they're now targeting gang members on site?
I'm not sure which years. So I would have to go back and look at those documents, Your Honor.
Because if you put together that they're looking for tattoos with the new policy of targeting gang members, it seems like there is a change in condition.
True, but it should also, it should also be noted that in his administrative appeal and his remanded proceedings, the petitioner in this case said that the police target and kill people in extrajudicial killings. So it was going on before this most recent policy.
I have a question about this issue of removal of the tattoo, because if what the police are looking for is a tattoo and it's removed, then presumably whatever danger is associated with that would be ameliorated. What is the government's policy or practice about assisting former gang members to have those tattoos removed?
Counsel is unsure, but petitioner's counsel in this case has never approached the Department of Justice requesting that we contact the Homeland Security about that option.
Well, I'm from the Central District, and I know in our district there's been a fairly active program to aid those who want tattoos removed. And so it's something that certainly could be done. There are organizations who are doing it with limited fee or maybe no fee in some cases. So it's something that should be explored, but the government, you have no knowledge as to how that could be done.
But again, if we had been asked, we would have been happy to approach Homeland Security about that option. And as pointed out in respondents' answering brief, there are multiple services in El Salvador that also provide this service to former gang members.
But isn't his claim that as soon as he gets back, he's going to be targeted, he wouldn't have time to go to some service once he's back?
But the articles in the record, Your Honor, they're former gang members, and none of them talk about being harmed. It's all about them going to the tattoo removal services in an effort to progress with their lives.
He has said that he doesn't have the ability to get his tattoo removed here. Isn't that correct?
That's what he alleges, but again, Your Honor, we would be...
I think he said, well, we'll hear from counsel on that, but he certainly said he doesn't have financial resources to pay for it, but that's not really a complete answer. If there are volunteers, as it sounds from Judge Marshall, that there are, that are willing to do this for no cost.
The agency seems to have thought that he could have gotten his tattoo removed here, but there's no evidence in the record to support that, is there?
Well, that was with regards to the social group finding, Your Honor.
But part of that, I know we're not discussing it, but in that discussion, the agency seems to have thought that he could get his tattoo removed, but I didn't see any support for that. I mean, I know Judge Marshall is saying that it exists in some places, but there's no evidence that it exists where he is or that the government offered it or anything, is there?
No evidence that he requested an opportunity to do so.
Well, and that should work both ways. I mean, it could be offered or requested. I'm not sure why that matters.
Does the panel have any other questions?
All right. Thanks.
Thank you. Government rests.
So I guess the first question that all of us would like to have you respond to is, to what extent have there been, have you tried to find services that may remove the tattoo without fee or limited fee?
Yes, Judge Burgess. So first I would point the panel to record page 39. It's paragraph 22 of Mr. Aguilar's affidavit. He talks about his inability to find anyone that would do this for him at Eloy. I would remind the panel he's been detained for 6 years. He didn't have counsel for 4.5 of those years. So he was operating in the dark for almost all this time.
Now he has counsel. Is there any impediment to finding one of these services to remove his tattoo?
So this is not part of the record. I do know that there have been efforts made by counsel to find a tattoo removal program. There apparently is a possibility in or near Eloy of a doctor that does this type of thing. However, it's not clear what the cost will be. And obviously here, unless ICE is willing to pay for it, this is something that will have to be done pro bono by the doctor, which at this point I am not aware of how that shook out. But even if we assume, Judge Graber, for argument's sake, that he could get it removed, I would point the panel to the Cole decision again, 659 F3rd at 786. It's argument D. And it talks about that even if some of these petitioners are able to get tattoo removal, they do have visible scarring that still gives the same appearance to a lot of the folks they run into in El Salvador. So it isn't as if it's just erasing a piece of, you know, pencil and paper and he walks away. He's still going to have that gigantic, it's his whole back that's covered with a tattoo. So it's not as if this is just a very simple, once you have the tattoo removal, everything's going to be okay. And the Cole decision makes that very clear. The last thing I'd like to point to, my timer didn't start, but I assume I'm getting close to time, is if we look to the Andrade case actually describes what the holding of Cole is. And one of Cole's holdings is that if you were looking at someone with gang-affiliated tattoos, and they are going to be facing removal to a country known for torturing gang members, the board has to actually assess that. They have to analyze that. Here, the board didn't analyze anything, much less analyze what was required to be done by Cole, as interpreted by this court in Andrade. So we're not looking at a situation where the board made some sort of finding and we're disagreeing with it. We're saying the board actually didn't follow this court's own precedent, given the circumstances of Mr. Aguilar. So when you combine the fact that the board didn't look to the country condition reports, the board didn't look to the real-life danger Mr. Aguilar faces, like no one here has said Mr. Aguilar isn't in danger. The board never said he's not in danger. The government's never said he's not in danger. Mr. Aguilar's in danger just a level of how much. So we're looking at this. The board didn't do any of the things that this court is required to do in the Cole, in the Andrade, and in the Aguilar-Ramos line of reasoning. So for those reasons, that's a separate basis for this court to reverse, just to understand what the board's actually trying to do. So for those reasons, we would ask that this court just reverse the board's holding and remand Mr. Aguilar's case so it can be reopened. We can reexamine the changed country conditions that exist now and see what the board does with all the things we've discussed today.
Thank you, counsel. The case just argued is submitted, and we appreciate the arguments of both counsel.